So we talked in the first video and we introduced a bit about Netlify and all that, but I thought like maybe it's a good idea to have one video explaining what JAMStack is for people that maybe they need to understand it more.
They're newer to the space and so on. Yeah. So basically, first of all, the JAMStack in itself is mostly a name for a way of approaching the architecture of building web projects, right? It stands for JavaScript APIs and markup. And it's based on this idea that instead of having sort of a big dynamic application that runs every time a request comes in and where and then generates HTML and sends it back to the browser, you start really separating and decoupling like the front-end presentation layer from the different dynamic functionalities. And you typically try to ship as much as you can as pre-built markup that's ready for consumption and can live directly on a globally distributed network. Then you use JavaScript in the client as sort of the main runtime and talk to all these different APIs and services.
So basically, as you get the kind of basic things, you get them as markup so that they are like kind of the steady base. And then you enrich that, you augment that with JavaScript APIs to add things like what? Like payment, like
It
shopping
can be,
carts?
yeah, basically anything that's a dynamic functionality, right? Like, so if you have an e-commerce, you might try to generate all the product pages up front and you have them ready. They live directly on a CDN. The load time will be as fast as it can possibly be, right? Like, there's no way you can get faster than that. People will browse very, very quickly. They'll have a great experience. Once they start putting stuff in a cart, that might be just a JavaScript component that manages all the state in the browser and so on. And once they click the buy button, obviously something needs to happen on a server somewhere. And that's where you would typically use an API, whether it's Stripe or whether it's like a more fully fledged like commerce layer that even wraps like the ordering catalog, or whether it's your own home-built serverless function that talks to Stripe. You end up having this API endpoint that gets involved when there's a real state change and when there's a real action.
So even like if I go and I want to search, that could be
Yeah,
something that you add on top of
that
the
could be
web.
something like Algolia, right? Again, you during the build process, you might index all the content into an Algolia instance. You ship the markup of all the products and everything in the browser. But then once a user search, you call out to Algolia that runs their own distributed network, right? And can give you an incredible speed from the browser on search, and a very great like user experience. But again, once that one that you as a developer don't have to worry about building and maintaining, you just sort
Or
of,
even hosting,
or
even if
even
you have it
hosting.
as a, you know, you don't want to host it,
Precisely.
which is also
Yeah.
complex.
Yeah,
And
precisely.
the same, it will be a component, JavaScript component that
Precisely.
works on
Precisely.
top of the markup that you
Precisely.
already have.
Yeah. And same, you might also see hybrids where you use some of the APIs at the actual build time where you populate the markup, right? Like, so Prismic would really often come into play at that point, right? Like, while you're populating the markup, you fetch content from Prismic, push it out. But then you might also see hybrids where you build out some of the core markup and push it out, but then from the client, there's no reason you also can't talk directly to Prismic as
Right.
an API and do things like filtering or aggregates or anything like that.
Or even, for instance, for us, previewing future content, it
Precisely.
should go into dynamic rather than the
Precisely.
case. So that's the
Precisely.
hybrid kind of approach between the two.
We're also seeing some cases where people, again, they want the best possible performance for most of the users. But what if you need to be able to push a breaking story, right? Like, then you might have a hybrid approach where if you go to a URL that's actually a 404, it might check with the content API, do we have a piece of content here? And if you do, just render it client side so you can like start getting results in front of people the moment you click the publish button. Even if below that, it will also trigger a build
The
that will
build
take it
anyway
out and
to
make
put
sure
it.
that everything is like pre-built and ready on a CDN and as performant as possible, but you sort of end up with the best of both worlds.
Right. And all these services that you talked about, for instance, you talked about search, CMS, you talked about, you know, the different services that you could be, the shopping platform, all these kind of things. The thing that is happening at the same time is that they are not a simple database. Nope. They are deployed in so many databases, their data stores and, and services and servers. Absolutely. It's a huge thing.
Yeah.
And host, even if you have it already built and you need to host it, it's it's a lot of work, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And instead of doing that, you have it as an API and you don't care.
Yeah,
it's absolutely. Like you don't need to understand how they're hosting it, where does it exist.
Nope.
You want it to be fast.
Yeah.
You want it to be global. That's all what you care about, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. That becomes more and more of a concern.
So now if someone has a JAMStack, like they need to, it's more about building that markup, right?
Yeah.
What kind of frameworks? Like you mentioned some, but
there's a whole set of them that falls sort of into different group. There's sort of the more traditional site builders like Hugo and 11t and Jekyll and so on that really like produces HTML and CSS and that's it. And that are really great for like producing those kind of content-based, like HTML, CSS-based sites, but doesn't give you much like in terms of like what would you do with the JavaScript layer later on, right? Mm. Like then it's up to the developer there. Then there are the ones that are sort of like Gatsby or Vuepress or GridSum, that are really based on producing, like plugging into something like either React or Vue, and producing, like doing sort of server-side rendering of React or Vue components and then hydrating them in the client. So they're more JavaScript heavy, but also gives you more of a framework for saying like, this is how I will then build client-side components and so on.
So it's a richer kind of setup?
Yeah. And then there are the ones that are really have started out as a single page application frameworks like Next and Nuxt, but then build in static pre-publishing for a lot of it, but are still very geared towards like these hybrid setups.
This is maybe the most interesting thing is that they are hybrid. So basically they can function as, since JavaScript, maybe what changed that is the fact that JavaScript now is running both on the server and on the client side.
Yeah.
So you can have it as a server rendered or build time rendered.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And then at some point you might decide, okay, that particular component, I want to make it run on the client to refresh something or to ask for some kind of state. And that hybrid mode maybe opened up for this kind of... there were a lot, like maybe 10 years ago, a lot of about mashups and mashing up applications and all of that.
Yeah.
But it didn't work quite well because we were not there yet, maybe.
Nope.
And maybe JAMStack is bringing that back.
We're definitively getting more there. Also just with the general idea of component-based systems, right?
Yeah.
Like I think we've seen that really become a big thing in across almost all the JavaScript frameworks, right? Whether it's Angular or Vue or React or Svelte or even web components with Polymer, right? Like we have this idea of a component, and that's a relatively recent development that's actually become something that you can really use and that you can start to compose with and so on.
But you know that idea of components, I've seen it failing so many times.
So many times,
everyone
right?
Everyone wanted to have components.
Absolutely, right?
It failed.
It's
every
not
time.
A new idea in itself, right?
No.
But it's a new thing that it started succeeding. Right?
No, it's succeeding, right? Maybe that's
really
the JavaScript thing that made it succeed. The fact that it's running on both sides, you know, you can.
I think actually it's more about the browser gaining maturity. And personally, I expect us to see over time less reliance on running the components themselves in the server. I think it's an interesting enough concept, but I think it's more based on like a random coincidence that years ago we started this dynamic generation of HTML from a program, right? Whereas as an architecture, it makes more sense to separate like the pure structure like presentation layer from the data layer. And fetch that data independently of the markup, right? I think it feels like more of a transitory state that we're still constantly
doing
like having a server build HTML on us
maybe
instead of
SEO.
Having
it's
SEO, but that's become like already now with Google that's become much less of an issue. And And there's like pre-rendering services that can take care of that concern.
On the hosting already.
You have
something like that.
We have something like that built in, right? Like which will just like for like crawlers like Facebook or Reddit or whatever.
Does it work well? I mean,
it works well. Yeah.
Do people use that kind of service?
Yeah, yeah. We have large, like we even have large media properties that use it that are very reliant on SEO, and it works well. I think during your whole, like taking a whole architectural decision just because of that SEO piece, it feels like a more of a temporary state, right? Like it'll be super relevant for years to come, right? But I do think
maybe that speed is the thing that we should take care of.
Precisely, right? Yeah. And I think that you can, like in the ideal world, we can get to a place with much better performance by separating the two.
Mm.
Because the more you separate the two, the more the two becomes cacheable independently, right? Like as soon as you have, if you pre-build all the markup, you can cache that for its side. And when you know if a user is authenticated or not authenticated, a lot of the data from unauthenticated users, you could probably also cache directly on a CDN, right?
Right.
You're already opening, and like with HTTP2, you're already like multiplexing everything through one connection.
And you
right?
can push things so, that are not exactly demanded. So you, precisely, in case of you want to optimize precisely. Caching and so, all these kind
so,
of things.
So you start having a lot of options where I think like the ideal performance, because the problem is as soon as you mix the data and the markup, like as soon as you do the server-side rendering, you typically lose the ability to put the result on a CDN. Mm. Even if you distribute, even in a world where you take serverless function and let's say you distribute those globally, the data source itself is most of the time localized. And most of the time when you render things from a data source, you actually want the running code to live not at the edge, but close to the data source.
But that's something, so it's funny that you're saying it. I didn't expect you to say it, you know, because for us, you know, as Prismic, I see why people are doing it. I see the results that nowadays brings a very good results.
Yeah.
But it's still like this two logics in two different layers.
Yeah.
And just the only reason is SEO, which is a very important reason today.
Yeah, yeah.
But imagine that disappears.
Yeah,
Your architecture can be way better.
Precisely.
If you do it only on the client.
Precisely.
You don't care about the other things. And you don't mix. This mixture is a bit tricky, you know?
Precisely. So that's kind of our vision of how can we get there where the architecture is really clean and much better and where it works like that. But of course, we also want to support like all the intermediary steps to get there and so on, right? Like so it's not like we are gonna like make it not viable to build in that way, right? Like I just personally think that the ideal architecture is this splitting it up and having more of a client to services architecture rather than.
Cool. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Maybe next video, we'll send serverless and then we'll do JAMStack.
Absolutely.
We'll be back to serverless.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Sounds good.